Okay, all right. So very good. Welcome back. And we will continue our lectures, and I'm going to introduce a new topic today. Okay. Does anyone want to guess what this topic is? Maybe you have seen, you know, the syllabus and all that. So
Laplace transform.
Laplace transformer.
You already saw the slide.
You already saw the, but I did not share this slide. No, I shared only the last lecture, right?
So we were able to see the introduction slide.
Okay, fine, very good. Okay, yeah. So I haven't put the slide. So I see the comments. Screen is not visible. Yes, screen is not visible. I will just start sharing soon. So this is what we are going to do. And I must tell you that, you know, yesterday night when I was making this slide, I mean, I have the previous slides. I was making modifications to the slide. I realized that we are well ahead of time. We have covered a bit more than we should have by this time. Okay, so I can go a bit slow. So maybe today, you know, I may not have a full 1 hour lecture unless you have questions. Okay, if you have questions, I'm happy to sit and discuss. So the slides may have less content, but I also thought it's good because we're starting a new topic, so let's go slow. Okay. So we are in very good shape in this course. I was a bit worried when we started, you know, online and all how it would be, but it's been fantastic as far as lecturing part is concerned. We are covering quite smoothly. Yes, verbal discussion is going on. Yeah. So I'm going back to the chat to see. You may finish the syllabus early, would give us more time to prepare too. Arpan, you are right, but you know, I was also a bit exaggerating. Okay, so yeah, maybe, you know, one lecture before I'll be able to finish maximum, not much more than that. Okay, we will see. Or what I can do is, you know, suppose I'm able to finish before, we can have a review lecture. So it's up to you. You don't have to come, but then you can come. We will decide later. Anyway, we have interaction session also. So it's a good suggestion, Arpan. I will keep that in mind. Thank you. So let me start. Otherwise, by too much talking, maybe I will not cover what I'm supposed to cover. So let me close the chat so that I don't see it. And yes, Utkarsh, thank you. Yeah. It was only that day. It was something, just that day. Yeah. So this is all being recorded. So let me not say much more. And I will go to the slides. So let me start sharing. One of you could, as usual, confirm.
Yes, sir. There is.
Thanks. So let's start. So, okay. So Laplace is, of course, a name that you must have seen in physics or somewhere else. Is that true? Laplacian.
Yes, sir.
So a famous French mathematician, very interesting character. If you look at the Wikipedia page, so usually I would have, you know, a slide copying from Wikipedia, which I will put on one of these days. But you take a look at it anyway. It's very interesting character, very interesting mathematician. Okay. So the only keyword in all the next lectures is Laplace transform. Okay. Next several lectures we are going to discuss Laplace transform. So we are going to start without differential equations. I will introduce the transform. We will study, you know, we will study its properties. Have you also heard about Fourier transform in some course?
Fourier. Yes, sir.
So these are very similar things. And so maybe, you know, some of you know some of these things already. But anyway, we will do it a bit formally. And we will introduce, you know, as days progress in next lectures, we will introduce more techniques in order to do all this. So next 2-3 lectures, we will deal only with Laplace transforms, not differential equations. But of course, we are doing it in a differential equations course because you have applications in differential equations. And it's a very beautiful method. I'm sure you will all like it. I personally like it a lot. And, you know, it's also a good topic in which tricky questions can be made easily. Okay. So I may be a bit mischievous. I may have some fun asking good questions. Okay. So let's start. So you are starting with a function which is defined on the positive real axis. Sometimes I might add zero, sometimes I may not add zero. You know, don't bother too much, okay? If zero is also part of it. So on open interval 0 to infinity to R. So it's a real valued function. Keep in mind, we are dealing with real valued functions as usual, not complex valued functions. And I am going to define the Laplace transform of this function. That will be another function. And I may have different notations, but right now my notation is L of F. This is another function. So I will have to put L of X and I should give you the formula, right? Because this is itself is a function. So I have to put the variable here. So I'm going to define, so L of F is the function defined by, and what I'm going to display is the formula for this function, L of S. Okay, so instead of X, I have put S here. S is a variable. So L of S is a function of S. So L of is a function. If you call it G, G of S. Okay, it depends on F. So I'm using the notation L of. And this is by definition, this integral. Okay, so what are you doing? You're integrating from 0 to infinity. What is given to you? 0 to infinity. You're integrating your function F of t dt. But you're not integrating f of t, you are multiplying with e power minus st and you are integrating, this is the integrand. Okay, so I hope the definition is clear. Take your function, consider the function given to you, multiply it with this exponential function where this variable s is coming, e power minus st, and then integrate. So you're integrating with respect to t. So if s was a number, the answer would be a number, right? When you integrate. But S is a variable. So what will be this integral after integrating? The T goes away, right? Because you're integrating with respect to T. So what will remain is a function of S. And that is what you are defining as LF at S. Okay. Now my first question to you. So sometimes we write, you know, this may be a better notation a bit later. We write our standard notation, small f is the function, which is real value. Keep in mind, it is real valued. And it's Laplace transform at S. This is a bit complicated in expressions to write many times. So I might write Laplace transform as capital F. Okay, sometimes we will, yeah, is there a question? Yeah, so we are going to denote it as capital F of S. So I may have many, many notations, yeah. Okay, so first question to you, LF is a function, but any function, you know, you don't talk of functions unless you know the domain and the codomain. So what is the domain of this function and where is it going to take values? What do you say? So LF is taking values for S and you are getting some answer in terms of S, right?
So,
T1 means what?
C1
means what?
F is continuous.
Oh, no. So no, that's fine. I understand what you're saying, but not quite. LF is already a function. Think of it as capital F. I'm asking about the domain of this capital F. S is a variable. So S is a real.
Asking about S.
I'm asking about S. Yes. Where is
S? Real.
Okay, you can take S real, of course.
That would depend on F, small f of t, because small f of t can be...
It does not depend on small f. I'm asking generally. Of course, you know, of course you are right. Depending on S. But very generally, suppose f was, you know, very, very good. I'm saying, you know, what is the domain in which you are looking at to start with? Maybe you will have to restrict a bit later.
Positive
real. So if you say S is a real number, I'm happy with it. You could have taken S a real number. Maybe, you know, you'll have to restrict. Depending on the function, you say, you know, this makes sense. See, integral may not converge, right? This problem may always happen. So you may have to say that, look, you know, S should be positive. Only then the integral will converge. Look, S has to be greater than 1000. Only then the integral will converge. These are possible. Okay, so in that sense, you are right. It depends on F. But in general, S could be a real number. But let me ask you, what if I say that S is a complex number, A plus IB, then also this makes sense, no? I mean, it may not converge, in which case we will have to restrict, but suppose it converges for some complex numbers, then also this makes sense, right? Your integration theory goes through. Okay, in which case you will get a function of a complex variable. But this is just a minor point that I'm making because we have a lot of time. It doesn't matter. Okay. you could take S2B. What I'm saying is, in engineering, when you are applying, you would like it to be a complex variable. You may have applications coming out of complex numbers, complex analysis. But for our methods, you don't have to pay so much attention to that right now. So you could take it from complex numbers or a subset of complex numbers depending on convergence. We will see as we do examples. And that's the next remark, that the integral above may not converge for every S. So here I am saying, you know, take it to be complex numbers. If you want to restrict to real numbers, you are welcome. But in some applications, you may need complex numbers. But then, you know, it may not converge for all complex numbers, in which case you will have to restrict. You know, I may say that if you're taking real numbers, I may say that S has to be positive or S has to be bigger than 1000. If you're taking complex numbers, you know, it may be something like real part of S should be positive or some such restrictions I may have to put. So wherever the integral converges, in that sense, one of you answered it correctly, it does depend on it. So let's go to the next slide, example.
That S will be on all reals, right? That S can be?
S no, this S no.
Why not? I didn't understand that.
No, I'm saying that S need not be all, suppose you know you want to take S to be all real numbers. Depending on F, this integral may not converge.
I mean, you said in general, no?
In general, to start with, you know, S could be all real numbers, but in which case I'm saying S could be all complex numbers also. You can go beyond real. Okay, so question was not a precise question. Here my answer is, you know, you can take it to be complex numbers. You don't have to restrict to real numbers. T is a real number. T is a positive real number, but S can be a complex number to start with. But the integral may not converge. It depends on the function, in which case you will have to put further restrictions. You may not be able to take all complex numbers or all real numbers. Is that okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So let's do examples. That will make it all clear. No need to, you know, say all this in plain English. Let's do the first example. That itself will make it clear, you know, what I have in mind. So let's take f of t to be 1 for all t positive. So this is constant function 1. My domain, I may not always say t is always positive. Okay, sometimes I include 0, doesn't matter. It is from open interval 0 to infinity. Okay, so constant function 1. So what is my question? Question to you is find the Laplace transform. So let's apply the formula. What is the formula? Integral, tell me. I mean, just say it aloud.
0 to infinity.
0 to infinity.
E raised to minus
ft times ft. Ft is 1. So integral, can you see a crow behind me? E power, yes. Yeah. Behind me meaning in front of me, what you see is a reflection. So last time when I was teaching an MSc elective course, so it was a smaller class. I had 18 students and my teaching hours were 2 to 3:30 in the afternoon and soon after lunch. And one day what happened was three or four eagles, not eagle, kite actually. I say eagle. So they were fighting right in front of me, you know, just 2 meters away from me. And I was a bit nervous. I was like, you know, should I go inside the house or whatever? And they could see everything, you know, I mean, the students could see everything on the on the glass door, the reflection, and I could see, and I was getting scared a little bit. But then later somebody told me that eagle is not going to come and attack you anyway. And that person joked that, you know, unless the eagle confuses your laptop mouse to be a real mouse, only, you know, if there is a prey, they are interested, not otherwise. Anyway, sorry. Yeah. So this is integral 0 to infinity e power minus st dt. And what is this integral? What is integral of e power minus st dt?
E power minus st by s.
E power minus st by?
S.
By s or by minus s?
Minus s. S.
By minus s. And this you have to evaluate from 0 to infinity. What will be the answer when you put infinity?
1 by s.
0.
So depend on like
0, 1. So minus of minus 1 by s. So 1 by s. All of you agree with this?
Actually, if S is negative, then
S. Exactly. So this is correct, but there is a question on S. E power minus S infinity is 0. You are assuming S is positive, right? Because if S was negative, then E power minus ST will be, you know, large as T goes to infinity. So it is 1 by S, but under this condition that You can say S is positive if you were taking S to be a real variable, but if S is a complex variable also, it is true, you have to assume that real part of S is positive. Okay, so if you write S equal to A plus IB, A is positive. So under that condition, this is true, and therefore our conclusion is what? We are computing Laplace transform only for real part of S is positive. So this is what we mean by restricting the domain. So what is my domain of the Laplace transform here? It is the right half plane. All A plus IB such that A is positive. A is strictly positive. Okay, that is my domain. And then 1 by S, whatever it takes, that is the codomain is C. I mean, range may be a subset of C, codomain is C. Okay.
Why, sir? I mean, it's, real part can also be negative, no?
If real part of S is negative, you are not taking that as the domain of your function, because this may not be true, no? If real part of S is negative, it will not converge, right? Real part of S is negative, let us say minus 2 plus, you know, something. Then you will get e power 2t, no? So as t goes to infinity, that will blow up. That will be infinity, right?
Okay.
So that is the reason, whereas you can check A plus IB with A negative, it will converge and that part will become zero and you will get 1 by S. So the way to check is, you know, you just check S is a real number and you need S positive, and if S is a complex number, you will have to just put real part. It will work. Okay. Is this example absolutely clear? So you have to remember some of these answers also. Okay. It will be very, very useful for you if standard functions, you know, Laplace transforms by heart. Okay, you should know how to get it, but you should also remember. I think that's going to be very easy. And the most beautiful thing is later we are going to have, you know, inverse Laplace transform. I will give you this function and you will have to guess what is the function for which that is a Laplace transform. And that is where, you know, in ODE, in solving ODE, you will have a differential equation and you will apply Laplace transform to the differential equation, which will make the differential equation to a much better usual equation. You will solve for the Laplace transform. But that's not the question. No, question is to solve the differential equation. So you will have to apply the inverse Laplace transform. So you'll have to be completely comfortable with various kinds of functions. They are Laplace transforms, so much so that given a function, you know how to guess the inverse Laplace transform for which there is no formula. Okay, so you have to have enough experience. So these basic examples should be absolutely clear. So the moment I say constant function 1, you should know answer is 1 by S. Forget all the details. It is constant function is defined only when greater than or equal to 0. S has to be positive. These are extra details, but you know, you should remember that for 1, the answer is 1 by S. And that if 1 by S is given, the inverse is 1. Okay, that both ways. Okay, and you have to be reasonably good at it. And this is going to be very important when you solve problems. You know, part of it is going to be your experience, not, you know, just the theory. Okay, next example. Let us take it. Yeah.
Go sir, ahead. I have a doubt in the previous example.
Yes.
Sir, can S be complex? If S is complex, we'll have e for real part of S into t plus e for imaginary part of t into I into t.
Absolutely.
What is its value? It won't converge at infinity, sir. The imaginary part.
It will converge if the real part is positive, because if S is equal to A plus IB, you will get.
About the imaginary part.
No problem, because you will get e power minus at into e power minus ibt. You agree?
Oh, into minus.
Right, and e power minus at is going to 0 and e power ibt is anyway bounded in between 1, no?
Yeah.
E power ibt is cos bt plus sin bt is something, no? So this will take care. Real part becoming negative will take care and it will converge.
Yes.
So next example, the function is e power at. So what is this function called? What is the name for this function?
Exponential.
We have done e power 2t, e power 3t, once again.
Exponential.
And what is t here? T?
Variable.
T is greater than or equal to 0, right?
True.
The variable t. And what is a?
Any parameter.
A is a real number, complex number, some other number. A is a fixed day, A is a constant, but that constant is a real number.
It can be, yes, it should be real number.
It should be a real number, right? Because
codomain of f is r.
Real valued function. So a is a real number. Okay. So now we will write down the Laplace transform, which is a complex variable. We may have restrictions. We will see. So if t is e power at, you can do the same thing, no? So t is positive. L of f of ss integral 0 to infinity e power minus st times e power at dt. And this is e power a minus st dt. The same strategy, right? This will be e power s minus a by s minus a 0 to infinity. And the answer is 1 by s minus a. What is the condition on s for this to be true?
Greater than the real part of it.
S is greater than a. Basically, if s was a real number, then s is strictly bigger than a. Otherwise, you will say real part of s is bigger than a. Okay, so it's exactly the same thing. This step also you should write, and you can analyze, and you got this answer. So very good. No, this matches with this. No, constant function one is what? Which a gives you constant function one?
Zero.
Equal to zero.
And the answer is fine, right? 1 by s minus a is 1 by s. Okay. So this is a general, more general example than this. Let us do more. F of t equal to sine a t. T is bigger than or equal to zero. What is a? Is
real.
A real number. So I'm going to do the Fourier transform. Once again, I'm saying Fourier transform. Laplace transform. Integral 0 to infinity e power minus st f of t dt. So strictly speaking, you know, we are never doing 0 to infinity. That means this 0 to b you do, and let b goes to infinity. Sometimes we don't write that, sometimes we write like that, which is this. And I'm going to do, so what have I done here? What is the word for this? This step? What is the word for this step?
Integration by
part.
Now you agree, no? E power minus st integral of sin a t is cos a t by a. No, integral of sine at is minus cos at by a minus of derivative of e power minus st is minus s e power minus st times minus cos at by a. So all put together, you have got this. Agree? Now what will you do? Most of you know how to do these things. What is your next step?
Again, apply by parts to the second term.
Wonderful. Okay. So in calculus, you would have done these kind of things. You are better than me in doing this. So again, apply integration by parts to the second term, and what will you get? You will get the original thing once again, right? And call that I or something and take that to this side, etc. And that's how you solve it. So again, apply, and I have applied again without giving the details, and I have put limit b going to infinity together. So believe me, you got this, okay? So 1 by a minus s square by a square. This is from again applying integration by parts. 0 to infinity e power minus st sin at dt. But what is this called? This integral is called the Laplace transform of sin at, right? Agree?
Yeah.
So what you have got is 1 by a minus s square by a square times the Laplace transform of sin at evaluated at s. Therefore, you have solved it, no? So when you take this to this side, you get 1 plus s square by a square times the Laplace transform is 1 by a. From which you can write down the Laplace transform. And why do I say real part of s is positive?
Where there did I use tends to infinity apply, e power minus st is there.
Third equation.
Yes. So you have applied it in order to, so you have applied it here itself, right? Everywhere you are applying. Here itself you have applied it in order to write 1 by a. And in the next step also you must be applying it. So everywhere you have applied it. So if s was a real number, you write s is positive. If s is a complex number, you write real part of s is positive. But what is the answer? Sine, if I just say sine, sine at, then the answer is a by s square plus s square. Okay. All these details will come at the next step. The moment I say sine at, it should, you know, I mean, it should occur to you, okay, the answer is s by s square plus a square. So if 1 by s square plus 1 is given to you, what is the inverse Laplace transform? 1 by s square plus 1.
Sin t.
These things should occur to you very, very fast, okay? Because finally, you know, the question may have a mix of various such things. So you have to be very, very comfortable with Laplace transform and inverse Laplace transform. Laplace transform has a formula. Inverse Laplace transform is from your experience. Okay, sometimes there may be a formula, but mostly from your experience. Now you should do these exercises, similar method. Cos AT is S by S square plus A square. What is the difference? Sine and cos?
Numerator.
Yes, for cos, variable is coming in the numerator. For sine, the constant came in the numerator. Okay, so cos AT is S by S square plus A square. Cos H AT, what is hyperbolic cosine? Cos H AT? What is the definition?
e power 80 plus e to the power minus 80 over 2.
So that you can check. Anyway, you know the answer for e power 80, and you may have to put this condition. And the answer is this. Check that. What should be my question number 3?
Sine at 80.
Sine hyperbolic.
And what should be the answer?
A upon s square minus a square.
So let's see. Yeah, very good. Okay, I was not so confident, and you were very confident, and you are right. Okay. So excellent. So do all these things. Okay. So this is how you develop this guessing game also. You should always guess. I mean, you should always try to guess. Sometimes your guess can be wrong. So be it. How does it matter? It's a fun. I mean, it's a game. It's a fun game. Guess it. If the guess is correct, you can be happy. If the guess is wrong, you know, you adjust your guess based on your experience. That's how we do mathematics. Okay. So sine at 80 is A by S square minus A square. But please do check all these things, and please check where you are putting these conditions while deriving it. Okay.
Sir, there is no harm for A to be less than zero.
There is no reason to be, that is correct. That is correct. I don't have to put this. I don't have to put this. That is only for stress. Okay. Sometimes, you know, even if that is obvious, sometimes we will put it in order to stress it. So this is only for that reason. You're absolutely right. Even if I did not put it, it is understood, because you know, our domain is 0 to infinity, for which A has to be positive. That's what you are saying, no?
No, sir. I'm saying A can be negative as well, because T has to be greater than 0.
So I'm saying the opposite. I'm saying A is also positive, because, you know, my function, always my domain is 0 to infinity.
But
Okay. Correct. You're saying that this just means T is positive. This doesn't say anything about A. At that time, you are right. But you do the exercise and see. Maybe you're using this in the proof. S is bigger than A.
Sir, we can just write real part of S is greater than mod A. Or we can make it a convention to take A as positive. Because even if it's negative, cos H of minus A T is just...
Yeah. But he was asking more generally, maybe. Not just about that example. So both of you are right, appropriately interpreted. But what I'm saying is, real part of S and S bigger than real part of S bigger than A. Okay, so it is for you to verify. You do the thing, and if that condition is not required, you tell me and I will remove it. Okay, but right now I can't say for sure. So real part of S is bigger than A will come. Now whether A positive also plays a role or not, you will see. So if that is most likely, it is required because exponential is coming. And if it is not required, fine, then you know that it is not really required. But in which case also, there's no mistake in writing this, because we are, you know, saying that under this condition, it is certainly true. Okay. So anyway, you verify all these things. And before doing the next example, I'm going to introduce what? If you are really observant, you can tell me. I'm going to introduce
gamma function.
Gamma function.
There in the title. And have you seen this already, or... have you done gamma function in calculus?
As a trick, it was taught in GE, but...
So let's do it with in a little bit more detail. So let's introduce the gamma function. It is also defined on 0 to infinity. It's also... we are evaluating it in R. More generally, you can do it in complex numbers also, but not for us. For us, it is real valued. And we are going to define this. So gamma of y, I should define. Y is from 0 to infinity, and the answer will be a real number. This is also an integral. And remember the definition. It is 0 to infinity e power minus x, x power y minus 1 dx. So I'm integrating with respect to x. So x goes away, and it will be a function of y. And therefore, it is a function of y. Agree? So you have to check whether it is convergent and all those things. If it is convergent, then this makes sense. Okay. and you are getting a very, very important function, gamma function. And we are first going to say that it does converge. And it's a very beautiful proof, which I did not come up with. I must have copied it from somewhere, maybe Wikipedia or somewhere, I don't remember. So the strategy to prove this is because it's so beautiful, I have, you know, I could have just asserted it and continued, but it's such a beautiful proof that I have copied it here. What you have to do is, you know, you convert this integral to 0 to 1 and 1 to infinity. And then say that this is convergent for one reason and this is convergent for another reason, and therefore the sum is convergent. Okay, so this is the idea. For the first integral, this is convergent. Now, you know, your x is between 0 and 1. So using the fact that x is between 0 and 1, so I should put an extra, one pause is missing here, see? It's coming together, so one typo. So e power minus x, x power y minus 1, when x is between 0 and 1, do you agree this? It's less than or equal to x power y minus 1? X is between 0 and 1. So e power x, 1 by e power x is less than 1, right?
No, sir, 1 by, yes, sir.
1 by e power x, e power minus x. So that is 1 by e power x. And is that correct?
Sir, shouldn't we place some constraint on y?
Yes, yes, yeah, correct. So absolute. No. We are doing integration as with respect to x.
We are doing
this integration for gamma of y. Y is
sorry, I missed the domain.
Y is a constant. Okay, forget gamma y. This is, once you prove that the integral is convergent, only then you can define it to be gamma y. So forget this part. We are just taking this integral and convergence of this integral. Now, what is the variable here? X. No, this is x going from 0 to infinity, right? Y is a constant now.
The integral doesn't converge for negative integer y or something.
If we put y equal to 0, then it is not.
The domain is 0 to infinity.
So that's what I was trying to say, that you have to limit the domain.
Yeah, I missed the
which
domain.
You already have.
You are
considering negative y. You are not considering negative y. Now, coming back to this question, this you have divided 0 to 1 and 1 to infinity, where y is a constant. And you are asking for convergence of this. Now I am saying that e power minus x, x power y minus 1. So I am checking, is this correct or is there a typo here? Is this correct when x is between 0?
Yes, sir, it's correct.
Yes, sir.
When x is between 0 and 1, what can you say about e power x? That is, I am not able to think. Is this correct?
So, yes, sir, it's correct.
And why is it correct?
Because e power minus x will be less than or equal to 1.
It drops below 1.
And x is positive.
Right.
E power minus x is less than 1.
Correct. E power minus x is less than or equal to 1, the same as saying e power x is bigger than 1, which is anyway true. So I'm not using the fact that x is less than 1. For any x positive, this is true, right? For
yes.
Any positive,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In particular, it is true here. Okay, that's why I got confused, you know. Why is x less than 1? So for any x positive, this is true. In particular, here it is true. And therefore, this is less than or equal to x power y minus 1 dx. And that integral makes sense 0 to 1. And the answer will be 1 by y. So the first integral is less than or equal to 1 by y, where y is a constant. And therefore, the first integral converges. Okay. And now we can look at the next integral, where the trick is very nice. I would not have thought about it myself. Sorry. So for the second, note that I'm writing this integral as e power minus x, x power y minus 1 as e power minus x by 2, x power y minus 1 times e power minus x by 2. So e power minus x by 2 into e power minus x by 2 is e power minus 6. And then I observe that this whole thing is less than e power minus x by 2, meaning this is less than 1. And that is also true. That is true when can you say that this is less than 1? Y is some constant, y may be 1000. Can you say that this is less than 1 if y is 1000?
For sufficiently large x.
Yeah, when x is very, very large, this is true. Whatever y is, when x is very large, this will dominate and e power minus x by 2 will go to 0. So for large x, this is true. So crucial point, when x is very large, this is my notation. Instead of greater than 0, greater than 0. That means very large. And very large is allowed because it is going to infinity. So when x is very large, see, only for a very big thing, you have to check convergence, because rest of the time it is 1 to some finite number where, you know, it will be convergent anyway, because this is a nice continuous function. Riemann integral will make sense. So convergence has to be checked only towards infinity and only towards 0 here. So for very large only you need to check, and then it is less than e power minus x by 2, and therefore the integral converges, because the integral will be less than or equal to 0 to infinity e power minus x by 2 dx, which is a convergent integral. Okay, so convergence is done. Therefore, gamma function is well defined, and you have the gamma function. And this, you know, comes very nicely in Laplace transforms. But let me do, you know, one more very, very beautiful property of the gamma function, which you will again see in courses 205 and 207. 205, some of you will take. 207, some others will take. You will see it again. There's a very, very beautiful relationship of gamma function. Gamma of y, if you multiply by y, you are going to get gamma of y plus 1. Where is this defined? Y is
then 0.
Y is here, y is positive. Only then this is defined. But that means y plus 1 also should be positive, right? But if y is positive, then y plus 1 is anyway positive, no?
Yes, sir.
The condition here is y is positive. Agree? If y is positive, we are planning to prove this. And let us prove this very beautiful integration proof. You choose a less than b and use integration by parts to see integral a to b. Why am I doing integral a to b? What will I finally do? I will take limit as a goes to
0.
0 and b goes to
infinity.
Infinity. So that's, you could have done directly 0 to infinity if you know what we are doing. But let's do it like this. So e power minus x, x power y dx. Why e power minus x power y dx? E power minus x power y dx. That means I'm taking gamma at y plus 1, right? Y plus 1 minus 1 is y. So this is for gamma of y plus 1, the left-hand side. Okay. Now we are going to do integration by parts. So what have I done here? I have done... what did I do here? I have done x power y times integral of e power minus x, that is minus e power minus x, minus of minus whatever, derivative of x power y is y x power y minus 1, y x power y minus 1 times integral of e power minus x. So this is just integration by parts, you agree? And that you evaluate, so here you will get a power y e power minus a minus b power y e power minus b, that is just plugging a and b, plus y times integral a to b e power minus, exactly as it is. And then you take limit as b goes to infinity and a goes to 0 from the right side. When a goes to 0, what will be this?
1.
Yeah, the whole thing will be 1. 1 or
0.
E to power minus.
Unless y
less than z,
unless y equal to
0,
y is positive.
A power y is 0.
Y is positive. So, and b power y e power minus b, as b goes to infinity, that is also 0. So this goes away, and what you get is y times, what will you get in the limit here? 0 to infinity, this. But that is what is called the gamma at y, no? So you've got the functional equation. Left hand side is gamma at y plus 1, and you got y times gamma y, all these things are 0 in the limit. So you've got the functional equation. Okay, so it's just integration by parts and a very, very beautiful formula. And in particular, so what is y here? Y is any positive real number. Suppose you take y to be a natural number. Suppose you take y to be 999. If y is 999, what did you prove? Gamma at? What did you prove if y is 999? Say no, I mean, am I asking two trillion? Gamma at 1000 equal to? 1000. Gamma at 1000 equal to?
999, gamma at 999.
999 times gamma at 999. But what is gamma at 999?
999
into gamma
998 into gamma
998 into gamma 998. But what is gamma
997
times gamma 997. Okay, so what you are getting is finally you will get 1000 times 999 times up to, you will get gamma at 2. Gamma at 2 will be 1 times gamma of 1, right? But you can check that gamma at 1000 is exactly 1000 factorial. Is it clear what is gamma of 1 from the definition?
It should be 999 factorial, no?
Yes, yes, 99. Yeah, you're starting with 999. Gamma at n plus 1 is n factorial. Gamma at 1000 is 999 factorial. So is it clear that, yeah. So the final step will be gamma at 1 will be 0 factorial. So gamma at 1 is 1. Is it clear that gamma at 1 is 1?
Sir, can I ask a question regarding, like we have not done improper integrals formally earlier, yeah. But so regarding how we, so we are basically concluding boundedness. Yes. But how can we be ascertain that just because it is bounded, we will have a proper convergence to a particular value?
For definite integrals, that is true. No? If you have a continuous function which is bounded, then it is Riemann integrable. No?
On a yeah, that was for like we did the normal integrals, not the
normal integral only I did here. Wherever I applied, that was only for normal integral here. No? Ah, okay. Okay. So here.
So basically, improper means we have an integral from a to b of the function dx, and we allow a and b to both tend to zero as a two variables.
That's exactly my comment here was. I'm saying here, so I mentioned that only at this stage, only x large enough matters. And I was giving an explanation why x large enough matters, because this particular integral, you can write as, suppose, you know, x bigger than 1000, this is true for whatever y is given. Then I can write this as 1 to 1000 and 1000 to infinity. And 1000 to infinity, this argument will apply. And 1 to 1000, what you are telling will apply. Because 1 to 1000.
Yeah, like I was asking, so we have basically written the integral to be less than some other integral over here. So 1 by y over here. And
that is only beyond a point, beyond 1000.
Yeah, so basically that allows us, so we had e power minus x power y minus 1 is less than or equal to x power y minus 1.
Yeah.
So from a to 1, so suppose we have not yet applied the limit a tends to 0.
Yeah.
So integral from a to 1 of e power minus x power y minus 1.
No, that is fine, that is fine. So, you know, those results about integration is true for any integral. If f is less than or equal to g, then integral f is less than or equal to integral g.
No, sir, like we know that the integral will be less, but how do we know that the lower integral actually converges to some value? What if there is some sort
convergence
of...
Convergence we are proving, no. Here the convergence, but what is the meaning of convergence? If this integral is finite, then this integral is finite. That's the meaning of convergence.
Like it might be that it does not converge, it kind of oscillates or something like that. And like no. The integral as a tends to zero, like in this case, it appears that it wouldn't, but like on a rigorous, at a rigorous level.
Yeah, yeah. So this is only a hint, you see. You know, I wanted to just assert the convergence and go ahead. But this is, you know, just giving you a basic idea. So you may have to put in a bit more explanation. This is the most basic idea, is to use this inequality at this step and to use this inequality at this step. That's all that I'm giving, not all the rigorous details.
Okay, because if we had done improper integrals, we might have done some theorems stating when we can be a certain convergence.
So that you have to analyze. So as you said, in this particular case, there's no complication, but you check whether there's a complication or not, in which case you will have to explain it. Okay, so that's why it is written, you know, this is just, you know, an aside. Because it's so beautiful, I thought, you know, I will put it in the slides. We only want the definition of gamma function to make sense. Okay, so yeah, my question is, gamma 1 is clear? What is gamma 1? What will be gamma 1? Gamma 1 is 0 to infinity e power minus x dx, right? Agree? Gamma at 1,
yes,
is 1 minus 1. So integral e power minus x dx is what? 0 to infinity?
E power minus x.
1.
Yeah, 1, no? So that's what. Gamma 1 is clear. So that is why it is n factorial. Because by induction, it will come down to 1 times gamma of 1. Okay, 1 times gamma of 1, but gamma of 1 is clearly 1. and therefore this is gamma of n plus 1 is n factorial. What you have done is an amazing thing. You have discovered a function which interpolates. You know the meaning of interpolates? What is the English meaning of interpolate?
Predict.
So given
values between two points.
Yeah, you're putting a fitting, right? So you have given n factorial, function n factorial. But what is the domain of the function n factorial? Natural numbers, right? So at each natural number, factorial, and you have a function. But you have got a real valued function which interpolates a factorial function, meaning you have got a real valued function, positive real value, which is defined on positive reals, but anyway, natural numbers are also positive. And what happens is at these natural numbers, it is fitting with the factorial. Okay, so this is very useful because with natural numbers, you cannot do analysis, you cannot do calculus, whereas with real numbers, you can do analysis, continuity, everything makes sense. So you have got a function, so you can do analysis in order to study something like factorial using the gamma function. Okay, very beautiful. We are going to use all these things. And this is a famous integral which you would have done in calculus.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
This strategy, what is the basic idea? If you give me one or two words, I will know that you know.
And we do e raised to minus y squared.
So first of all, you call this indefinite.
Use double integrals.
I or something. And I is also integral 0 to infinity e power minus y square dy. And what do? You take 2y or I square or I cube or
I square.
And that will be a double integral. And then the
polar form.
Exactly. So dx dy you will write as r dr d theta. And then it is easy to evaluate. So you get the answer to be root pi by 2, right? So this is what it is. So this is what you have told me. Now we can compute gamma of half, gamma of 3 by 2, etc. Right? Gamma is defined for y positive. At natural number, it is n factorial. But gamma of half, we can compute. Gamma of half by definition is e power minus x, x power half minus 1, minus half dx. Can you suggest the change of variable which will make this integral easy?
Root x equal to t.
Root x equal to t. X equal to t square, right? So when x equal to t square, gamma half becomes twice 0 to infinity e power minus t square dt. And therefore, what is gamma half because of your calculus exercise? What is gamma at half?
Root pi.
Okay, wonderful. No, this function at half, it is giving you a beautiful answer. You know, pi after all is a very important number and it's a square root of pi, which is a value at half. So in other words, half factorial, if at all that made sense, the answer is root pi. Okay.
How to solve the d power minus x square dx, sir?
That's a calculus thing and here is a hint. So you please check this. You call it I. I can also be written as integral e power minus y square dy. So I square is the double integral 0 to infinity e power minus x square times e power minus y square dx dy, which is e power minus of x square plus y square dx dy. You make the change of coordinate x equal to r cos theta, y equal to r sin theta. So x square plus y square will be r square and dx dy, you know, in calculus, it is r dr d theta. Do all that, you will get the answer. You will get I square to be whatever and take the square root. Okay, so do that. So what is gamma of 3 by 2? You tell me the answer. If gamma of half is root pi, what
pi
is
by two.
Root pi by 2?
Absolutely. So half times gamma of half by the earlier functional equation. And therefore, it is half times root pi by 2. So you can do gamma of 5 by 2, gamma of 7 by 2, all those things. Okay. There is another thing which I don't think I have put it in my slides, but very, very beautiful idea. Gamma function is defined only for y positive, right? Only then the integral converged. But now that this functional equation we have proved for y positive, the right hand side makes sense whenever y is positive. But this also makes sense whenever y plus 1 is positive, no?
Yes, sir.
It makes sense whenever y plus 1 is positive. So suppose I take y equal to minus half. Left hand side makes sense, right? If I take y equal to minus half, left hand side makes sense. Agree?
Yes, sir.
Right hand side, the integral definition does not make sense, but let it not. let me just blindly apply this formula. What will you get? You will get gamma at half equal to minus half times gamma at minus half.
Yes, sir.
Therefore, you can define gamma of minus half using this formula, no?
Yes, sir.
So gamma at minus half, the integral doesn't make sense. That is not your definition anymore. But using this formula, you can define gamma at minus half.
Now we can define even gamma at zero, no? Then
you can define gamma at zero also using this formula. Using this formula, can you define gamma at minus 3/2?
Sir, how to define it at zero?
I'm defining it using this formula because gamma at zero, well, gamma at zero, you have to be. Gamma at zero, you can't because you cannot divide by zero.
The prop, sir, I had
so gamma of negative integers also.
Yeah, gamma at negative integers also, there may be a problem because at zero there is a problem. That's why I'm asking about minus half and minus 3/2.
Sir,
minus half, there's no problem, right? Because you can divide by
y equal to zero.
What about -3/2?
-3/2.
-3/2, can you define or can you not define using this formula?
Yes,
we can define minus half.
Yeah, you can define using the definition of minus half, right? So using this formula, you can define at all negative numbers except for, I think somebody already answered, except for
negative integers
and zero. Okay, except for that, you can define. So this is another thing. I don't know whether we are going to use it or not. So,
sir, so the earlier domain that we wrote in the definition, so we have to use that or the new one.
Yes. So you are saying that the integral definition of gamma function makes sense only positive real numbers, but observing this formula and using that formula, you can, you know, extend the definition length one at a time to the negative axis, length one at a time up to minus one you can define, then using that definition up to minus two you can define, using that definition up to minus three you can define. You will have to remove these negative integers because of zero complex, there's a singularity at zero. So there's a singularity, that singularity propagates. So there's a singularity at all negative integers. Okay. So I said there's not much today, etc., etc. But I see that I have already exceeded time because, you know, I thought there's not much. So I went really slowly. And but anyway, we are going to finish soon. So this we have done. And I said something extra also. And I think this is the last slide. Let us do this very beautiful calculation. I'm going to do the Laplace transform of t power p whenever p is bigger than minus one. So consider the function. Up to now, we have done constant function t. We have done e power at. We have done sin at. We have done cos at. We have done in the sense you will do. And we have done sin at at. We have done cos at at. We haven't done anything else, right? Yeah, these are the things we have done. Now we are going to do Laplace transform of t power p. P can be any real number bigger than minus one. So Laplace transform of t power p by definition is integral 0 to infinity e power minus st t power p dt. And I'm going to make this change of variable x equal to st. Okay, x equal to st. And therefore dt is, dx is s dt. Therefore dt is dx by s. So substitute. So the Laplace transform at s is integral 0 to infinity. St is called x, so e power minus x, t is x by s, so x by s power p, and dt is dx by s. Okay, but this is 1 by s power p plus 1, s power p from here and s here, 1 by s power p plus 1, 0 to infinity e power minus x, x power p dx. But what is this? What is the right hand side?
P factor.
P is not a
p plus one.
Natural number. P is any real number bigger than minus one. So what is the right hand side?
Gamma
of p plus one.
P plus one.
The answer of Laplace transform of p power p is gamma at p plus one by s power p plus one. Is there any condition on s? Is there any condition on s?
Sir, when we are writing the integral from 0 to infinity for x, actually, like, st would be complex. So it's a complex integral, right?
Yes.
St would be moving along a ray from origin to infinity, right, along the direction. Of,
yeah. That is, you can continue the computation using that. Or, you know, if complex is confusing, you take S to be real. Either way, it's okay. S complex is fine. But is there a condition on S that you are using? Like earlier, we had S bigger
greater than 0.
Greater than 0.
Greater than 0 are we using? Yes. So real part of S bigger than 0. Where exactly are we using it?
Limits 0 to infinity.
Yeah, limit 0 to infinity. You must be using that. So please double check. You are using this condition. And under this condition, now by heart, you should know this. Okay. When I say T power P, answer is gamma P plus 1 by S power P plus 1. Okay. So tell me now, what is the inverse transform of 1 by S power P plus 1?
Sir? T power P by gamma P plus 1.
Correct. Because gamma P plus 1 is a constant, right? So P is a constant. So inverse transform of 1 by S power P plus 1 is T power P by gamma of P plus 1. Right? What is the inverse transform of 1 by S cube?
Sir, can you repeat?
I'm asking what is the first question, what is the inverse transform of gamma P plus 1 by S power P plus 1?
D squared by gamma T.
Since somebody asked this question, I'm going back to my first question. What is the inverse transform of gamma of P plus 1 by S power P plus 1? By definition, the answer is T power P. My next question was, what is the inverse transform of 1 by S power P plus 1? But this is a constant, so you just divide this by that constant. So T power P by gamma P plus 1. Then I asked a specific question, what is the inverse transform of 1 by S cube? 1 by S cube is P equal to 2. T square by 2 factorial. Gamma of 3. Gamma of 3 is 2 factorial. So answer is T square by 2. Okay. So many inverse transforms are hidden in this formula, and therefore L of T power N in particular is N factorial by S power N plus 1. Does this match with our very first example, constant function 1? What is constant function 1?
Equal to 0.
N equal to 0. And is it correct here? What is 0 factorial?
1.
Yes, sir.
1.
S power 0 plus 1, S. So 1 by S. That matches, no? And real part of S is positive is anyway there. So this matches, yes. Is good. For P equal to half, so again a typo, this much should not have come together. Anyway, doesn't matter. So P equal to half, if you put L of T power minus half, L of T power minus half is gamma of half by S power half, which is square root of pi by S. Just applying all the formulas that we know. And L of T power half will be gamma of 3 by 2 by S power 3 power half. So you are doing, so we have done some number of examples of Laplace transform. And this is my last slide, and I have exceeded time, though I thought I would finish before time, 12:40 almost. So let us stop here. Let me stop.
Normally, for what functions do we define the Laplace transform? Like
wherever we can integrate.
Because there might be functions which are not zero identically, but have a Laplace transform of zero.
We will see. We will see. In electrical engineering and all, you have to use those functions.
Because if we want the inverse to be unique, we would need that it be one.
Yes. So I'm you know, today whenever I talked about inverse, that was not really part of the class. This was just to, you know, what do they call? You know, there is a good way of saying this, right? Make the tempo correct or whatever. So put you in the correct mood, okay, for the next lectures. I wanted you to experience this guessing game. So not very rigorously. So inverse transform, in order for it to be well defined, etc., we may have to throw in some assumptions. Yes, you're right. But whatever examples we have done, all those will make sense anyway, inverse. So I wanted you to have, you know, some comfort level with guessing inverses, which is going to be very important when you solve differential equations. Yeah, I should stop recording. Yes, thanks.